To the one who saved us. good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. For me, it's almost been 2 weeks since I was here in the house of the Lord. And I am so thankful today, amen, to be able to be here. Amen. We are living in challenging times. And don't know that anybody knows the answer except the fact that Jesus is the answer. Amen. And I'm glad to know that this season that we are in, we are not alone.
Amen.
And no doubt there are challenges and there are sad days and difficult days that we haven't lived through. And maybe there are more ahead of us. But the same God that has brought us this far, amen, will take us to the other side.
Amen.
Because our hope is in Jesus Christ. Our hope is not in this life. Even if the very worst could happen to any one of us, the greatest things that could be imagined are before us. Amen. We have hope.
That's right.
Hope that's beyond this life. You know, David said, I was glad that I saw the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And I can say, like David, I have seen the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I'm alive and I've seen the goodness. But what's so great is the best things that we can experience in this world pale in comparison to the good things God has prepared for them that love Him and look for His appearing. So thank God for His goodness, but I am so hopeful and so thankful that I have something better prepared for me next. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Amen, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Good to see everyone here today. Amen. And all of you that aren't here today that may be watching through these cameras, we pray that you can experience the same presence and to feel the closeness of the Lord as we feel here today. Amen. Thankful for all of you that have been faithful in your giving. Thank you so much. Amen. The electricity is on. The heat is on. And we'll be standing in here until this season is over because of your faithfulness. So this morning we're going to do our declaration that we do over our prayer, over our giving, and have found it to be a blessing. I mentioned this last Sunday. I was here. A friend of mine called me that day, and someone unexpectedly was able to give the church a $1 million check. And he said, you know, I had someone tell me years ago that prophesied to me the Lord was going to help the church with the debt that was there. And on that day, somebody gave the church $1 million. In addition, that same season, someone had been blessed and given an inheritance that they would be able to give over $20,000 a month in, say, perpetuity, but in the foreseeable future. And I say that to say that, you know what, a lot of people make all kinds of proclamations on all kinds of things, but the greatest thing you can proclaim the promises of God is in your faithfulness, because God has promised us.
Amen.
So upon that, upon the authority of your word, I have given, and it shall be given to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am a tither. I bring my tithe today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked. The curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not room enough to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mails, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts dismissed, royalties received. My greatest desire is to see my whole family saved and walking with God in perfect health and abundance, to walk in divine favor and blessing. I am blessed going in, I am blessed going out, and all that I do will prosper in Jesus' name. And let the church say, amen. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we thank you today for your abundance that we enjoy every day. We thank you, Lord, for the abundance of your spirit. We thank you, O God, for the fullness of your joy. We thank you, O God, for your all-powerful name. And Lord Jesus, today, Lord, we thank you that you are faithful. that you are faithful to us. And Lord Jesus, today we celebrate the faithfulness of your people. Lord Jesus, we celebrate, God, the goodness and grace that we receive through your people. Lord, we ask you today that you, oh God, would pour upon each one of them, Lord, blessings that they are incapable of accounting or containing. And everybody said, in Jesus' name. Can we give the Lord a praise? Hallelujah. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
It's good to be here on this Sunday morning and to know that the Lord is in charge of our lives. And I'm thankful for that. So very thankful. I know most of you saw, but yesterday was a happy day for Brother Nate. Brother Nate, she said yes, so he was very happy. And we're very happy that she said yes. We're pretty excited. Not really a big surprise. We kind of saw that coming. But we are very thankful for the love they have shown each other so far. And there's so much more love to go. Amen. So very happy for that. It's wonderful to see good things happen to people that you love. And that's one of the great things about that, not just having family, but having church family, because there are people that have been praying for you and encouraging you and believing in you since you was a little one, and they can rejoice to see the hand of the Lord in your life, and that's such a good thing. Amen? Amen. Brother B.J. Randall's going to come and bring us the word, and as he comes, I'd like us just to stand together and raise our hands and ask the Lord to use this man of God to speak to our hearts. The Lord still speaks, and one of the ways he speaks is through the ministry. Lord Jesus, we pray that your Spirit would communicate today. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I worship you this morning. God, I thank you today, Jesus. Speak to us today, God. Lord, I love you today, Jesus. I love you today, Jesus. And hasn't the Lord been good to us?
Amen.
I trust you all had as good a Thanksgiving as you could under the circumstances. I will say mine was quite restful and peaceful, and got to see some family, eat a little food, and all those sorts of things. So God was good to us. Amen.
Amen.
I know that He has been good to you. As you are standing this morning, if you would, turn in your Bibles with me. And we will read from Proverbs, the 23rd chapter. We'll read verses 10 and 11. Proverbs 23, verses 10 and 11. And after that, we'll also read Proverbs 22 and 28. Proverbs, the 23rd chapter, verses 10 and 11. I'm so thankful for the opportunity today to speak to you, to be in the house of the Lord with His faithful, believing, amen, trustworthy, good folks. Amen.
Yes.
And I'm just so glad today that you are here. Amen. I, like you, I wish there were 100 more right beside you. But the Lord knew who would be here today. And I mean, I believe the Lord is faithful in His word. He's faithful to His people. Amen. He has something in store for you today. Proverbs, the 23rd chapter, verses 10 and 11 say, "Remove not the old landmark, and enter not into the fields of the fatherless, for their Redeemer is mighty. He shall plead their cause with thee." And if you'll turn back one chapter to Proverbs, the 22nd chapter, in verse 28, it says, "Remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set." Remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set. Amen. Let's pray to God. Lord, we thank you today, Lord, for this opportunity to preach the word, to teach. Lord, I pray today that you would open our ears and our hearts. Lord, I pray that your spirit would move in this house. Lord, that the words that are coming out of my mouth, Lord Jesus, would be what you would have in store for us. Lord, I pray that you would do the work that only your spirit can do. Do the things that my words could never do. But God, work in this house today to accomplish that, Lord, which you would have come to pass. Pray this in the lovely name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Man, I want to preach a little while today. Preach, teach, a little of both about landmarks. I just want to preach a little while about landmarks. Now, if you've been around Pentecost very long, you've probably heard people preaching or making mention to landmarks. Amen. It's something that I've certainly heard preached many times in my life, but if you are a student of the Bible, you know that the idea of landmarks was very important in the time, especially the time of the Hebrews when they came out under the leadership of Joshua, and the Lord gave them a fair and goodly land called Canaan. And under Joshua's leadership, the children of Israel came out of the wilderness and they crossed that Jordan River. And they began to conquer the land of Canaan. That was a land that was promised unto Abraham. And God renewed that promise to Abraham's descendants, to Isaac and to Jacob. And in the fullness of time, under Moses' leadership, God led them to the edge of the Canaan land. And there was a period of trials and a trying time in their history. But finally, they were able to possess the promised land. The Bible calls it a land that was flowing with milk and honey. It was a land, though, that was not empty. It was a land that had inhabitants already in it. But in that place, that land of Canaan, it was inhabited by people who, generally speaking, you could call them Canaanites. And they did all sorts of wicked things. They had all sorts of evil ways of worshiping their idol gods. And they had all sorts of things that they did that was abhorrent to God. In fact, God would not let the people of Israel go into Canaan land until the wickedness of the Canaanites was full. And at that time, God
sent them forth under the leadership of Joshua to possess the land. And they went about a series of wars and conquest. And you can, of course, read all about that in the Old Testament. But needless to say, they eventually possessed the land that God had promised, because God always fulfills His promises. And they possessed this land, and they were the beneficiaries of homes that they did not build. And they got to reap harvest that they did not sow. And they got to glean the grapes from vineyards that they did not plant. They got to eat off of olive trees that they had not tended. And the Lord richly blessed them. And so it was as they conquered this Canaan land that the land was divided amongst the 12 tribes of Israel. And from there, the land was parceled out to different family groups. And as they parceled this land out, they set up borders. And inside those borders for each tribe, they had fields, because they were a very agrarian society. They were people that if they were going to eat, they had to take care of what they had come into possession of. And they had to sow crops, and eventually they had to plant their own vineyards and till their own fields. But the Lord was blessing them, but He gave them wisdom. And this wisdom was that as you were dividing things up, you have to set out boundaries. You have to set landmarks. A landmark was an object, and oftentimes these objects were maybe movable, but they were objects that were meant to define a boundary or a line. Now, if you are to drive today into anywhere that raises crops, like if you go into the Delta, or if you go up into the Midwest and you see crop fields beside each other, a lot of the bigger tracts of land, they don't even have fences on them, because fences are expensive to build and maintain. But a lot of times you'll see old tree lines that denotes where a property line is. There's a marker there, because the farmers have to know what their field is and where their neighbor's field begins. And in the ancient times of Israel, they would have something on the borderline or on the property line marking a boundary. It may be a stone that was set, or it may be a post. But oftentimes these things were movable. They were movable. It was something that if you put some effort into it, you could slide it over. Okay? So there were boundaries and there were properties that could be used. And today we'll use this basket as, this is going to be our landmark. Is that okay? This is our landmark today. So they would have a landmark that was here. And that landmark was set by the forefathers. And that landmark was not to be moved to the left. It wasn't to be moved to the right. It was there for a purpose and for a reason. The scripture that I read to you from Proverbs, the 23rd chapter, "Remove not the old landmark and enter not into the fields of the fatherless." I was contemplating this morning and thinking about, why does it mention the fatherless? As an agrarian society, the men would be out in the fields mostly doing the planting and the harvesting and the manual labor of the field work. But if it came to a time that the father passed away and you had a young man, come here, Brody, you can come up here this morning. You're going to help me preach. And let's say this over here is Brody's family, represents Brody's family still. His dad was over there, and the other neighbor was over here. They're working, and that's fine. But let's say the man of the house had died, and all that left over there was children, young kids, couldn't fend for themselves, didn't know how to raise crops, didn't know where the property lines may be. There was no deed down at the courthouse showing. And so many feet from the highway, there's a pin that marks the parking. There was no deed at the courthouse. There was no thing that you kept in your possession there that showed that proved that you owned the property. All that was there was the landmark. And so a child, maybe this field grows up and it's not being used. And a neighbor that is a untrustworthy person or a thief, they can move and say, you know what, I like this field. They're not using it. I think I'll use it. All the kid knows is daddy had a fit. All the kid knows is daddy used to raise crops and do all that. And he's not ready yet. And so what have I just done? I've increased my field by 25%. And the kid has no one to stand up for it. No one to stand up and say, hey, that's yours. This is your inheritance. And so what has happened is there's been a theft of land. And so the kid comes up, and now he's of age where he's raising crops, but he's not able to raise enough. He's not able to make the money and prosper as the Lord had saw fit for him to prosper. Because what was his was stolen because somebody moved the landmark. I'm going to pick that pill up. I'm going to assume that a kid don't need to take that. I don't know what that is. It's not candy. It's not a Tic Tac. Even though it's brightly yellow colored, it's not a Tic Tac. Remove not the ancient landmark. The Bible says that God, their Redeemer, is mighty, and He shall plead their case for them. So this very act of moving a landmark in the Old Testament was tantamount to theft. It was considered to be theft. It was a way which unscrupulous people could acquire more goods or acquire and enhance themselves and enrich themselves, but at the cost of other people. In fact, the Bible had a lot to say about it. In Deuteronomy 19 and 14, it says, "Thou shalt not remove thy neighbor's landmark, which of old time has set in thine inheritance, which thou shalt inherit in the land that the Lord thy God shall give thee to possess it." Deuteronomy 27 and 14, "Cursed be he that removes his neighbor's landmark, and let the people say, Amen." Hosea 5 and 10, "The princes of Judah were like them that removed the bound," or in other words, landmark. "Therefore I will pour out of my wrath upon them like water." So we have the wrath of God and people being cursed because they moved the landmark. And what's so important here is that the landmark not only represents your land, but it represents the inheritance that was going to go down from generation to generation to generation. Just as the children of Israel inherited land that their forefathers had given them, I have in my life, and you have in your life, landmarks, boundaries that have been placed. These are not physical boundaries, but if you'll follow the metaphor today, a landmark is something that can be described as boundaries or as truths that have been instilled in the lives of believers. These landmarks are placed through impartation, through preaching, through prayer, and through revelation. Boundaries are indicative of a godly inheritance that is left by a righteous people. I can tell you today that I have been the beneficiary of an inheritance. Things that were set before me and things that were placed in my life that were just given to me. And there was times that I did not understand the importance or the value of the inheritance that was placed in my life. But now as I get older, I've come to more fully appreciate things that have been placed in my life, things that have been preached to me, things that have been taught to me from the time that I was just a little guy. Things like faith, the importance of the faithfulness to the house of God. Things about how you're supposed to treat other people. How to treat your wife right. How to work hard. How to provide for your family. How to pay your tithes. Amen. How to show up at the church on work day. Things that were instilled into me. Amen. If there was a work day at the church on Saturday, you best believe I was going to be there to help. Now, I may not could do anything but walk around the church property and pick up trash and put it in a trash bag. But I was going to be there. When the doors were open for prayer meeting, my family was going to be at prayer meeting. On Wednesday night service, we were going to be there. Amen. When pastor called a fast day, the family was going to fast. We were going to read the Word, and we were going to pray together at night. There were just things that were given to me, an inheritance that was passed down to me. And this inheritance doesn't just go back to my parents, but it goes back to my parents' parents and to their parents. It goes all the way back into the early 1900s. It's something that has been handed down to me generation upon generation upon generation. This week I was able to spend some time with my dad's parents. He had went and gotten them and brought them over. And they are now in their mid-80s. And you know, they can't get around like they used to. My grandpa was a hard-working man. But he just can't work the way he used to work. And my grandmother was a fantastic cook. But she just can't cook the way she used to cook. Her eyesight's bad, and their hearing's not what it used to be, and they don't have energy. They take 2, 3, 4 naps a day because just getting up and getting around and talking and doing the everything that you do in a daily life just wears them out. But they still have a fire and a passion that burns down inside of them for the things of God. So I was sitting there with them, and my grandmother related to me, and she said, "You know, BJ, we just don't have much in the way of worldly goods. We don't have much. We just have a little bitty old trailer in Louisiana. We don't have any great savings." She said, "Oh, but son, we have this precious truth. We have this truth. We have the revelation of the mighty God in Christ. We have the revelation of the mighty God in Jesus. And we have the revelation of one God. We have the revelation of water baptism in the name of Jesus. We have the revelation of the importance of the infilling of the Holy Ghost."
Amen.
We sat there and she began to tell me, and she always likes to tell me things. She said, "Come here, son, let me tell you what the Lord's been talking to me about. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be." Amen. "When the Son of Man returns." She began to tell me what the Lord had been dealing with her in her spirit, what she had been thinking about, what she had been praying about. And that's a precious, precious memory and inheritance that I have. That's something that money cannot buy. You have something inside of you today that's been put there. Amen. There's something that money cannot buy. It's more precious than land. It's more precious than houses. It's more precious than your job. It's more precious than all the wealth that you can accumulate. And that's the truth of the Word of God. It's the truth that's been put into us by our elders. It's been put into us by little gray-haired ladies and old bald-headed men that knew how to pray and knew how to be faithful to God and knew how to tote the load when the going got tough. And when it got tough, they didn't give up. And when there was times of famine and times of want and times of need, they were faithful to the house of God. They were faithful in their giving. They were faithful in their prayer lives. They were faithful in the Word of God. They were faithful. And not only were they faithful in their personal lives, but they instilled it in generations upon generations that came after them. And who are we today to say that we can move the landmark?
Yes. Amen.
There are boundaries and borders that have been placed. There have been monuments to men and women of prayer that have been built. And who are we today to let those landmarks fall into disrepair, or to move them for our own convenience, or to move them over so we'll have an easier life? They've sacrificed so much. They've bled and they've gave till it hurts. I have a testimony of my mother's grandfather. He was a poor man. Amen. He I didn't know I'd get emotional this morning. He was just a farmer.
If the truth be told, he was a failed soybean farmer.
But in the times in the 80s when the soybeans went downhill, the market fell out. He did his very best to keep his family afloat, and he did what he could do. But for years and years and years, every year, he didn't have a big savings account. He didn't believe in living on credit cards. He didn't believe in going out and financing a bunch of stuff. He was old school. He lived through the Depression. But what he did every year for many, many, many years, he would go to the bank in town and borrow $1,000 and give it to the church and pay it off. You just don't know how bad they hurt. You don't know the sacrifice that went in to keep the doors open on a little church out in the sticks so that somebody could hear the truth, so that somebody would have a testimony in their life, so that somebody could get deliverance, so that families could hear the truth preached on a little backwater church. That flooded when the water came up. They had to build the church up and still water would get into it. But there's so many people in that community that the sacrifice of those old people didn't mean anything to them. Didn't mean anything to them. They let the churchyard grow up. They moved off and went to other churches. They moved out of the community because one generation, even though there was a landmark set in front of them, they don't love truth. They'd rather booze and drug and dope and run around than follow the examples of elders that were set before them. There's a whole generation of young people in that area that I'm from that have lost. They've lost everything because of methamphetamine and heroin addicts and drunkards and dopers. Because they didn't love the truth that was set before them. And now their children are growing up to be drunkards and dopers and running around and living in the ways of the world. All because somebody did not value the landmark that was set before them. They didn't love it. They didn't love truth. Oh, you don't have to live that way. Oh, that's not necessary. That's not necessary. So I'm here to tell you today, the landmarks that have been established by the elders, the landmarks that were established by the Word of God, they still stand for something. They still mean something. Holiness is still right. Holiness is still right. Living a life that's pleasing to God is still right. Prayer is still needed. We still need to be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. We still need to believe in this one God message. Amen. We still need to believe in the landmarks. It's important that we not only admire. Amen. I've met so many people that my grandma, I tell you, boy, she was a good woman. My parents, they were good praying people, and they admire them, but they don't love their birthright. They don't love their inheritance. They're just like Esau. You know the story of Esau in the Old Testament. Esau goes out. He goes hunting. He's not successful. He comes in. And he's hungry, and there's his brother, and his younger brother's cooking a bowl of bean soup or whatever it was, lentils. He's cooking his beans, and Esau says, oh, I'm hungry. Jacob, the younger brother, says, well, if you'll give me your birthright, I'll give you some beans. And for a bowl of beans, Esau gave up his birthright. The Bible says that he despised his birthright. And that's the way so many people are in our day and hour. Their grandmothers and their fathers and their mothers and their great-grandparents, they admire their walk with God. In fact, if they need prayer, they know who to call. Yes, they call the praying people, the ones that are still living truth. Right. They admire what they see in others, but do they really love their inheritance? Do they love their birthright? It's not enough to admire Jesus from a distance, but Jesus wants us to be close to Him. He wants us to draw close unto Him so that He can have a relationship with you and with me. Proverbs, the 23rd chapter, verse 22 says, "Hearken unto thy father that begot thee, and despise not thy mother when she is old. Buy the truth and sell it not. Also wisdom and instruction and understanding. The father of the righteous shall be greatly rejoiced, and he that begotteth a wise child shall have joy of him. Thy father and thy mother shall be glad, and she that bare thee shall rejoice. My son, give me thine heart, and let thine eyes observe my ways." You got to get it down inside your heart. It's not enough just to have praying mamas and daddies. Amen. It's not enough, but we've got to love it. We've got to get it down on the inside of our hearts. I thank God today for praying mamas and praying daddies, but there's going to be a day when I can't pick up the phone and call Brent Randall. There's going to be a day that I can't talk to J.K. and Francis Randall. I've got to have it inside of me for myself, and I've got to start instilling it and keep instilling it in Brody and in Braden. Hey, Noah, there's going to come a day when you're going to have to instill it in little Noah Jr. Nate, you're going to have to instill it in some little red-headed kid you're probably going to have. Blonde or red, strawberry blonde. You're going to have to instill this truth in them. You're going to have to tell them about Grandpa's testimony, about how he was addicted to drugs, and God brought him out and delivered him, put his life back together, and healed his mind. Amen. Every time he tells me that story, I get happy. He's told it to me a dozen times, and I hope he tells it to me a dozen more, because every time he tells me about how God put his family back together and delivered him from drugs and healed his mind, I say, if God would do it for him, God would do it for me. And if God would do it for me, He'll do it for my children and their children. And there's a landmark that has been set.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. It's a testimony that has been set before us. Proverbs 13 and 22 says, "A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children." Amen. Grandparents, you leave an inheritance. Amen. It may not be money, but it can be an inheritance of truth, an inheritance of love, of unconditional love, an inheritance of faithfulness to the things of God, an inheritance of prayer. Amen. Every time you get that grandbaby in your lap, you ought to whisper the word of God in their ear and pray over them. Amen. Well, there's been grand times when, and I know as a grandchild, there were times when I wish my grandparents would just let me go so I could go out in the yard and play with my cousins. But they'd hold me and say, "I've been praying for you. The Lord's going to do things through you. The Lord's going to use you. The Lord wants to use those talents that He's given you for His kingdom." Amen. There was old men that used to pull me aside. Elder North pulled me aside. "Oh, son, you're good. You're playing that bass good. Let me tell you something. Don't you ever play music in a juke joint. Don't you ever use that gift that God gave you for the devil." He put his finger in my face and told me, "Don't you ever play in the bars." I've never played in the bars. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I won't. Because He put something on the inside of me. He preached truth into my life when I was just a little tot. Amen. You set the way. Amen. Train up a child. Train up a child in the way they should go. And when they're old, they will not depart from it. Amen. You show them the landmarks. You tell them what the landmarks are for. You tell them why there are boundaries. You tell them where the boundaries came from. Every boundary that we have is rooted and is grounded in the Word of God. The Word that will never pass away. It's rooted in precious promises and precious truths that come from God. And there have been elders that have kept the boundaries where they are. And it's up to you and I to make sure the next generation knows what the landmarks are all about. Right.
My Lord, come on.
Elders, 1 Timothy, the 5th chapter, verses 1 and 2, says, rebuke not an elder, but entreat him as a father, and the younger men as brethren, and the elder women as mothers, and the younger as sisters with all purity. That word there means honor, with all honor. Give them honor. That's why traditionally in the Pentecostal church, I don't just call the brother Billy. I don't just call him Billy. I call him Brother Billy. I give him honor. I greet him as my brother. That reminds me that Brother Billy and I are family in Jesus Christ. He's my brother in Christ. Amen. Hannah's not just Hannah to me. She's Sister Hannah. She's my sister in Christ. So I'm to give her all the honor that she is, that's due to her. The elders here, they're not just my elders, but I view them as father figures. They're role models in my life. Amen. The sister, Sister Gloria, is as a grandmother to me. I love her like I love my own grandparents. She means a lot to me. She's prayed for me. She's taught my kids. She's helped us. Amen. She's a grandparent. So we give her honor today as she's in part of my family in the body of Christ. It takes mothers and fathers. It takes grandparents. It takes elders. It takes younger brothers and sisters to make the family of God whole. It takes all of us to raise and to create a community of faith, a community that loves truth, a community that is devoted and committed to doing whatever it takes to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. It takes all of us. So we have to make sure that we do not water down, that we do not remove, that we do not discourage the preaching of the truth of God's holy word. Let it be said of us when our days are, if God should tarry, and our days are getting long, and my hair gets gray, and I'm sitting on a pew, hopefully, if God should allow it, and I'm sitting there and I can't do much. Let it be said of me that he was found to be faithful, that he was found to be true, that he was found to be a preacher of the Word of God, that he still acted on the outside of the church like he acts on the inside of the church, that he didn't have a double life, that he brought his kids to church, that he gave in the fund, in the offering, that he gave in his tithes and his offering and gave of his talents and of his time. I want it to be found to said of me, like they say of the elders now, that they were faithful, that he was prayerful, that he was giving. Amen. 1 Timothy, Paul in here is being writing unto Timothy, which was his son in the gospel. He says in Timothy 4:11, these things command and teach, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word and conversation, that means manner of life, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. If I could preach to you young men this morning, I would tell you, don't let anybody despise your youth. In other words, yes, you are young, but there are things that have been entrusted to you that are just as true now as they will be should you live to be 80 years old. And that's the truth of the Word of God. These things have been put into you. Amen. They weren't put into you so that you could become a reservoir of truth, but they were put into you so that you could be a well of truth that can be drawn out of, that can be shared. Amen. Give attendance to what things? Love, the Spirit, faith. What else did he tell him? Purity. Purity. We got to keep ourselves clean. We got to keep ourselves clean. We got to give attendance to studying, to reading, to the doctrine of the apostles. Neglect not the gift that is in thee. God has gifted you with certain things. You've got to develop those gifts and use them for the kingdom of God. Brody and Braden, God has gifted things to you. You've got to develop those gifts and use them for the kingdom of God. Amen. God has given you gifts. He didn't give you gifts to be used for the world, but He gave you gifts to be used for
His glory, for the furtherance of His kingdom, for the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. These gifts were given by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Amen. I can't tell you how many times that I had elders pray for me, lay their hands on me, had men of God preach over me, prophesy to me, and they put things inside of me. Amen. But I can't let that end with me. Now it's time for me to begin to pray for kids and younger people and lay hands on them and pray that God will use them and to exhort them to keep themselves spotless, keep themselves holy, clean, and separated from the world. Remind them that they need a prayer life. Remind them that they need to study the Word. Remind them that they need their own relationship with Jesus Christ. Boys, it's not enough that Daddy prays, and it's not enough that Mama prays, but you've got to find your own prayer life. You've got to find your own relationship with God. But neglect not the gift. There's so many that have been given, but they're like the one, the parable of the talents. They're like that slothful servant that goes into the talent and he buries it because he's afraid what'll happen if he loses it. God's not worried about you trying and failing. He's not worried about you trying to fly and falling to the earth. He upholds you in His hand. He holds you in the palm of His hand. So that gift that God's given you, you spread your wings and you fly. You go out and you proclaim the gospel. You do what God has put in your heart to do. You do what He's commissioned you to do. And you don't worry about the failures. And you don't worry about who laughs. And you don't worry about what so-and-so has to say. But you do what God has called you to do. You sing your song. You preach your message. You pray your prayers. You lift your hands and give your worship. Because the only opinion that matters is that of the Master. And the Master doesn't want you burying your talent. But you stir it up and you neglect not the gift that God has put in you. Yeah. Neglect it not. Meditate upon these things, he says, and give thyself wholly to them. That's W-H-O-L-L-Y. Give thyself wholly to them. You can't give yourself partway or halfway to the callings that God has put in your life. You got to give yourself wholly to the calling and the giftings that God has given you. Amen. It's not enough, as you musicians know, you can't just want to play and sing and just show up and hope it happens. You got to give yourself wholly to that. That means what? That means you have to practice. That means you have to learn the words to the song. That means you have to learn how the chords go together within the song. That means you have to learn how to sing parts and sing harmony and all those things that have to happen inside of that. If you're a young man that's called to the ministry, you have to learn how to pray. You have to learn how to find the mind of God and how to study and how to put your thoughts down on pen and paper or in your notebook or your tablet. You have to learn how to craft your message and put it together. And you have to learn how to pray about it and fast about it and pray that word into your spirit. Amen. You have to give yourself wholly to that craft. If you're a soul winner, you have to learn how to communicate with people. And you have to put the word inside of you. Because if you're going to share the gospel with somebody else and win people to the truth, you got to have it inside of you first. So you have to learn how to do that. Amen. There's so many things that God has gifted us with. If you're an encourager, you have to learn how to bring an encouraging word at the right time. And how to not say things that distract from that. If you're somebody that likes to share your testimony, you have to guard your witness. Otherwise, when you share your testimony and try to win somebody, they say, oh, I know what you've been doing. There's things that God has called us to and gifted us with, and we have to give ourselves wholly to that. And when we do, it will be evident to all. Yes. that thy profiting may appear to all. And when God uses that gift and that talent that's inside of us, and we build it up and we craft it and we work at it, it's not for our profit, it's not for our benefit, it's for the benefit of the church body, for the church as a whole. And God designed it that way.
Amen.
Take heed unto thyself and unto thy doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Timothy was called to be a pastor, called to be a man of God. And what Paul was telling him, if you give yourself wholly to this calling, amen, you're not going to only save yourself, but those that hear you. And that's the ultimate goal, is that those that hear us, those that are within our touching, within our reaching, those that are within our realm of influence, that God, people that God's put in that circle around us, that we could touch them, that we could witness to them, that we could reach them, not only in our words, but also in our actions and how we treat each other and how we treat them. Amen. It is the will of God for that to happen. Amen. Young men, I wish there was some young ladies. I mean, there's some young ladies, but she's really, really small. Amen. There are some landmarks that have been set before you. Some landmarks of truth. Brother Nate, Brother Noah, Brother Brody, Braden, it's up to you guys. Amen. There's a generation that's going to be coming up after you. It's going to be up to you guys to say, hey guys, here's the generation. Our generation is going to stand for truth. Here are these landmarks. We're not going to move the landmarks. We're not going to cut them down. We're not going to water down the truth. But we're going to stand for what our elders have put inside of us. Amen. Let's stand this morning. Mighty God, I love you today. Lord, I thank you, God, that you saw fit, Lord, so many years ago, God, Lord, to put a hunger and a burden in my life, God, for truth. I thank you today for the landmarks that are in my life, God. I thank you for the examples, God, that have been set before me. Lord, I pray today, God, that each and every individual here today would be encouraged, God, that this word would go with them, Lord Jesus. Mighty God, I pray today, Lord, that we would move not the landmark, the ancient landmark, the old landmark that's been set. God, for we don't want to be a thief, God. We don't want to be someone, God, that's guilty, God, of stealing the truth. Of hiding it from the next generation. Someone that's guilty, Lord, of moving the boundaries, God. But Lord, we want to hold the line, Lord. We want to toe the line, mighty God, the way that is set before us. Mighty God, I know today, God, that there are times, Lord, that it seems harder than ever, God, to stand for truth. But God, strengthen our resolve today. Lord, you are sufficient for us. You're sufficient for this hour. God, you are sufficient for the times in which we live. God, be our sufficiency, God. Be our strength, God. Be our buckler and be our shield, God. And the darker the hour gets, the darker the times, the brighter the light of the truth shines. Lord, strengthen our courage and our resolve to stand for you, God. Come what may, no matter what happens, God, let us, Lord, be found faithful to the things that you put into our life, faithful to our callings, faithful to our giftings, faithful to this doctrine, faithful to the truth, God. Mighty God, we thank you today for what you've given us, God. We thank you for the heritage that's been passed down to us today. Mighty God, we're so thankful. God, we're so thankful. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh,
receive this word from God today. I'm so thankful today for the ancient landmarks that are in my life. Thankful for people that love the truth enough to give it all.
Amen.
People that cherish the truth. People that make tremendous sacrifice for the truth. Amen. And I want to be one of those. I want to be one of those. Somebody would say they stood for the truth. They loved the truth. They were faithful to the truth.
Amen.
Amen. I want to be one of those people. Amen. Thank you, Brother. Brother B.J. Randall. What a wonderful message today. Amen. That fed my soul. That fed my soul. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. You know, you've heard it said, one man's trash is another man's treasure. Sadly, some men's treasure is as much as other men's trash. Amen. I don't think I've ever heard the story about your grandfather and borrowing $1,000. Wow. That's what you call sacrifice. Amen. Some people couldn't be bothered to give an offering while other men will give what they don't even have. Thank God. And it is people like that. Their blood, their guts, their sweat, their love for truth in which we stand. Amen. It would be a tragedy to see all of the generational blessing and commitment that's been made in our lives just in this crowd we have here today. We've got so many people, righteous people, that have made such investments. Amen. And what a tragedy it would be for me or for you or for us to walk away from as just so much of nothing what they gave their whole life to. I know there have been people and there are people that have done that, but not me. I want to be accounted among the righteous and the faithful. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother BJ. What a wonderful message. Wonderful message. Hallelujah. I know this morning I got here early, as is my habit. And just had such a wonderful prayer needing conversation with Jesus today. And I have great sense of hope, a great sense of anticipation that the Lord has something great for us.
Amen.
Amen. He has something great for us. Father, we thank you today for this day and this wonderful atmosphere, Lord, that you have given us, Lord, in your word, your preaching, and your ministry, Lord. Thank you today for the ancient landmarks that are in our minds and in our hearts, Lord, and in our not just in our heritage, but they are before us in our destiny. Jesus, we pray, give us an opportunity to reflect the same commitment. Lord, give us, Lord Jesus, the platform, Lord, in which we can declare, Lord, in whatever obscure or private way, Lord, maybe it may not ever be known or public, but help us, oh God, to be worthy, to be counted among those heroes of faith. Jesus' name, bless everyone here today that we are in the pursuit, Lord. We are striving forward. I pray, God, this week would be a week marked with your blessing. Lord, the blessing of your presence, the blessing of your communication, the blessing that we would hear what the Spirit is saying to us, oh God. Help us, Lord Jesus, to be able to be an echo, Lord, to speak forth, Lord, what you said to us in secret, Lord, into the hearing of those that need to hear it, that need it confirmed in their hearts. In Jesus' name, Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Well, if Jesus doesn't come between now and Wednesday, we will have our normal, awesome midweek service. It will be incredible. God will bless us and we will be blessed.
We will so much enjoy what God's going to do here Wednesday. Amen. Everybody say, praise God. Amen. 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 You look good playing the piano. Amen. I look like Nate agreed with me, so. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, you're dismissed in Jesus' name. And